Okay, so let's get started. Today I'm going to do a daemon dash on VSFTPD, as I mentioned earlier, the very secure FTP daemon. And actually, I don't think this will be terribly long because luckily it's fairly easy to use and set up. So I've got some scenarios to show you guys, and I'll show you the config for that. But overall, it's pretty easy. This is sort of my go-to FTP daemon if I want to set something up. Because I've got most of the config flags memorized, and it's really only two or three config flags that you need to know to set it up, whether you want to do anonymous FTP or if you want to do sort of a web host scenario where you want to be able to upload web files to your server. So first I'm going to switch it back to the default config and just show you guys what that looks like. So this is the default config file that it comes with, and by default it's got pretty much everything turned on, which is probably the only gripe I have with it. By default it comes with anonymous FTP enabled, so when you first set up the server, it's going to, whatever directory you've picked as your anonymous directory, it's going to start letting people look at that. So if you have something existing that's there, it's gonna let people start looking at that. And it also by default enables local accounts. So if you have any real user login accounts that aren't root, they will be able to log in over FTP and they'll have access to your file system over FTP. And for some reason my cell connection is crapping out. Yeah, well, it's still active here.
You can use mine.
Let's see if it'll reconnect.
Brad's Pixel.
I'll try this one more time, and then I'll switch to yours if I need to. Maybe my phone doesn't like running a hotspot on 5 gig. How do I leave full screen on PuTTY? I forget.
Alt-Enter.
Okay. Apparently that doesn't work when your session's dead.
Alt-Space.
I think I have to go restart session and PuTTY the window.
Yeah, Alt-F.
Oh, there we go. I can get it right there. Right, as I was saying. So by default, anonymous login is enabled, and local enabled is also enabled. So what that means is that any local users who aren't root, like I said, are going to be able to log in with FTP and their regular user credentials, and then they'll have whatever credentials their user has on the system across the whole thing.
Very quickly, are you using Vim there?
Yes.
Could you do a syntax off and take a look at the screen? I can hardly read it.
Yeah, blue is something. Blue is just comments anyway.
So. Syntax space off. There.
There we go.
Yeah.
It's harder to see the uncommented
ones. Yeah, I don't know if that's...
Which are the ones that we're really interested in seeing.
Just look at the first column, I guess.
So So local UMask, this is setting how it's gonna UMask files when it uploads them. So this is gonna override whatever the user's default UMask is. So if you want to make sure that any files uploaded are only gonna get read write for the user that's uploading them, then you would change this to 077 like it mentions above, or whatever particular UMask that you want in your situation. Luckily by default, anonymous upload is turned off, so at least they're not gonna be able to write crap onto your server. And then most of the year is just sort of system stuff and compatibility. The dir message is a compatibility thing. Logging settings, and then lots of it's just commented out. So by default it mentions here, VSFTPD has ASCII mode completely disabled, which is fine with me. By default it will pretend to go in ASCII mode and then not. And then so you can actually go in and you can turn on ASCII mode for real here if you really want the headache. It's got this is another anonymous feature, banned email list. So if you're familiar with how anonymous FTP works, normally when you log in, often it'll prompt you for your email address as the password. And so sometimes they say certain DOS bots use a list of common emails to log in as. And so I guess you can put those all in a list and then it'll just kill those connections. It won't even let them anonymous log in. There's an option to chroot users, and I'll get into that a little later. And it also supports IPv6 if you'd like it to, which I won't show. Listen option is telling it to run as a daemon. You can also run this under xinetd, and you can configure when it starts and how it starts then, and then you would turn this off, because then it's just running as an executable at that point. It integrates with PAM, so it does the regular PAM user checks that a normal login would do, and you can customize that. It's got its own PAM file. VSFTPD is in the PAM.d, and you can tell it, you can give it the PAM requirements. So for instance, it's checking the shells, and it'll see if there's a bin no login or a bin false in etc password for a local user. That'll fail as one of the shell requirements from PAM, and then they won't be allowed to log in. So that's nice. So the defaults there are quite good. User list is by default a blacklist, so like I said, root's not going to be able to log in by default, and you can change the behavior of that as well. So I will quit out of that, and I will pop over. I'm just going to use Windows FTP because it works.
Is there a way you can change the background screen color on those terminals? That might help. If you change it to, say, some beige thing or something, you'll see both colors.
I think the size will be.
The font size a bit.
I'll lift to 18. Or switch to it. Oh, not good enough.
I think bigger in there?
Yeah, pick a different font. No, I have to change a different font.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I see.
Use
we've got three fonts.
Fixed width type. I can't see what he's got there.
All right, that should be okay. There isn't a whole lot to see. So we'll open my server, and the first thing we can do is we can do an anonymous login, and here it's going to let us in. So that's actually I should have done a. And then so it's prompting us for a password. Now it's not actually enforcing the email as a password, so you can really just enter in any jumble of characters and it'll let you in. It's just prompting for a password, and the tradition is that that would be an email. Now at the same time, we can log in. And we can also specify a local user, and I think that user exists. And it let me into the server. Now, as I mentioned, by default, it's not doing any chrooting. All it is relying on the local file system permissions that a user has. So anything that's world readable is going to be accessible from your FTP daemon. So for instance, if I do a print working directory, right now it knows I'm in /home/Wyatt. So if we want to say go to /etc and we want to get password, we can, because it's readable. So some random person on the internet could go in anonymous mode and they could read that. So it's up to you whether you consider that a security risk or not.
This would be ch-rooted to its
By default, I forget if it is or not.
Yeah, I think it is.
It is, after all, very secure.
Yes, okay. So I spoke that wrong, but yes. Anonymous is at least ch-rooted by default, and that's configured from the FTP user, which by default exists on most systems, and you can configure where that home directory actually is. But local users aren't. So if you want to ch-root your local users, say you're running in sort of a web host situation and you only want your FTP, you create a web FTP user and you say, okay, well this user can only upload files to var www.html. So let's add a web user. Oh, it's user. Oh, that doesn't even exist. And then if we go in and we switch our config to tell it to chroot any local users, so we'll go into our config file. So we're going to tell it to chroot local users, and then when user web logs in, they should be chrooted into var www.html. Actually, I need to give it a password. So now as we logged in, it thinks we're in slash. We won't be able to touch any files because the ownership on that directory, but if we go into var www.html, we can see that there's our HTML file in our directory. Now, one problem with VSFTPD's chroot requirements is it won't accept a chroot if the home directory, the base home directory, is writable. And so it becomes a problem when you want to run certain web apps like WordPress, for example, expect to start right at root, and they want to just write, they don't want to switch into a directory to write their files, and so you end up where it logs in and it can't write, so you need to do a little bit of shuffling in order to get it to work over FTP. And the, at least back when I was, a couple years ago when I was working with it, WordPress will only do an automatic update over FTP. It logs in to FTP and then it moves its files around and does the update. Otherwise, what's that?
They have fixed that.
Yeah, okay, good. Otherwise, you just had to do it manually. So that was one issue I ran into with this. So you'll see if I Oops. CHRL web, web, HTML. So now that this HTML directory is going to be, is writable by the owner, web. So when a VSFTPD tries to chroot web into HTML, it's going to go, your home directory is writable, or your root directory is writable. I'm not going to let you log in.
I don't know when they added it, but apparently there's an allow writable chroot config option.
Oh, yeah? That must have been fairly new. I mean, back when I was doing that, it was a couple years ago, so I wouldn't be terribly surprised.
We used to call it chroot.
And maybe they've already compiled it in by default. See if there's. Okay, so apparently that default behavior's changed. So never mind. By default now, you can have the root directory writable, and it will let you log in and do that. So that's fixed. So that's better in my opinion. So now let's say you don't want any local users at all. All you want to be able to do is anonymously download files. You want to post lectures or something on your FTP server, and you want people to go and download them, and that's all you want to be able to do. Even better, let's say you want you've got students and you want to keep a record of who downloaded your file. So you'll keep the password there and tell them, you know, type in your email as the anonymous password, and then you know who downloaded the file. That's just an excuse for leaving the anonymous password enabled. So if we go back to the VSFTPD config, I am going to, I've got a couple of pre-made ones, so I'm just going to relink. So let's see what's in here. It's all basically the same. Anonymous enable equals yes. And here I've set the anonymous root so that by default that's reading off of the FTP system account. We can override that here. And so I've just assigned it to this home directory of a different user, FTP upload. And then here we've said local enable equals no, so it's not going to take any local user accounts at all. We're going to make sure nobody can write. And then that's about it. That's all we need to do. One of the other default things you can change is this FTPD banner. So when you log in with a client, it'll print out that little welcome message, and you can say welcome to blah 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 FTP server. Doesn't have to be set or not. It's up to you. So now when we connect to mug.ca or mug.magitech, we log in. We say anonymous. And it's going to prompt us, we're going to say student. And now we're able to get in. So there's an upload directory in that file. Now at the same time, so if we try again, and we try with web, who was previously allowed to log in, it'll just say fail. You didn't use anonymous, just you're not even allowed to log in. It'll only accept the username anonymous. Now if we really just want people to go there and download files, we don't even care about the password at all, then all we do is I think it's no dereference. I just always remember SFN. So all we've done here is we've added the no anon password. So that just says don't even prompt for a password. Just as soon as you get the anonymous login name, just let them log in. And we're in. And so same thing, we're here in the upload directory. Okay, let's see, what else do I have? So now, conversely, if we only want local users to log in, we can just disable the anonymous options, so we'll do that here. And then we try this again, we try and log in anonymous, and it's going to treat anonymous like a local login user. And so we can specify a password, and it's not going to let us in.
What does VSFTPD do if I actually have a user ID called anonymous?
I think it'll let you in. Let's try that. No, it should create a home directory automatically.
Okay.
I think.
Mm-hmm.
We'll do this to make sure.
Yes, it is fine under default.
My connection died again.
Alt space.
There we go. Okay, we definitely have a home directory now. And lets us in.
So it just disables special cases of the anonymous user.
I guess so, yeah. So now let's see what happens if we turn it back on.
It's got a mask. Gotcha. Yeah. Mask it, not mask it.
So yeah, it masked the local user.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Neat. That also needs to be able to log in with FTP. So the
social engineering hack. Change your name to Andrew Anonymous.
Is that like Bobby Brown tables?
So as I mentioned, by default, it's got a blacklist on standard usernames. So if you look just in the default directory here, it's got user list. And so if we take a look at user list, here it's, these are all the accounts that you'll never want to log in with FTP with, hopefully. And you can see actually here they put this comment in right away. So by default, user list, no, this is talking different. So there's user list enable, and then this is all, and then there's another option, user list deny. So when user list equals deny, then this actually turns into a whitelist, and then if user list deny equals yes, then this is turned into a blacklist, which is kind of funky. Yeah.
Easy way to shoot yourself in the foot.
But you'll notice that one is not user list deny.
No, this is user list enabled. So this turns into, this actually performs the same thing, except reverse. So user list, no.
User list enabled enables the processing of the file at all.
And then the default is to put it in deny mode.
Yes, you're right. Yeah.
Because deny is yes.
Yeah.
Is the default.
Yeah.
And that's essentially for reverse compatibility with older versions of FTPD where it was a deny list.
Yeah.
And there was no way to override that.
So if we add in user list deny equals no, and then we add in, we'll move that to so we're only going to let the web user log in. And so here, well, first we'll try and log in as another local user. And right away it's just going to go denied. It's not even going to prompt for a password. It's just going to say, no, can't log in. But if we do web, no, user web.
That's actually a sub-channel attack right there.
Yeah. It should delay the same amount of time.
It should at least ask for a password.
Yes, yeah, true, depending on...
Because then you can probe for what user ID is allowed.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Pretty large key space, but you could probably guess the obvious ones.
Exactly, yeah.
So here we can log in as web, and it's just like a normal login. So I think that covered most of it. So pretty much all of the options all of the options that I've used are in the man pages. I use this as the standard reference. It's all well documented. Basically, it's actually not terribly long. Read through the whole things and look for all the options that you want to use. Well, I forgot to mention it will do FTP over SSL. I don't have that set up to demo, but it can be done. If for some reason you would want to do that over SFTP, but you're better off doing that most of the time.
Actually, it's only 3.5 trillion items that you have to scan. For most systems.
Maximum username length?
8.
Yeah.
That's reasonable. Now it is. That's
I'll show you guys, might as well show you guys the user mask feature. So by default, so if you look in www.html, you can see that this password file that we uploaded has the correct ownership, but you can see it's got 644 permissions on it. So we can go into our config file. And we'll tell it, don't give any permissions to anyone other than yourself. And on a web server, you wouldn't really want to do that. And then let's delete that password file. And so there you can see, it's got 600 permissions on it. So the UMass did its job, and now nobody other than web is going to be able to look at that file. So if you want to have a shared upload directory, you can have the permissions set so that anything you upload to there is going to get the right permissions, or it's going to just totally remove write Yes.
Do you know if it supports the systron command?
The which?
Systemctron.
I don't know. What does that do?
Well, on FTP servers, if you do SYST space and then extended set of commands.
So you try to help there.
Systhelp. Space. Oh, did I misremember the command?
Try to help.
Try quote help. You might have to do quote assist help. No, like literally the word quote.
Quote assist help?
Yeah. Not a lot. I'm guessing that's a no.
How much is quote help?
Yeah.
There we go.
Well, it does have cyst. It doesn't have CGP.
But it has cyst.
Well, yeah, okay, so this is branded Microsoft FTP client. Okay. Oh, it's got mode. That's how you can set it. Mm-hmm. So you do quote space mode space. And I can't remember if it's filing and then octo or octolib filing. Probably.
No.
Actually, in this case,
the
mode. The mode.
Oh, okay.
So I try 666 space password. Try the other way. Yes. The mode health mode. Now, hold on. Well, it'll have a way because it lists numbers about the command. Of course, it also has re-end as a command, so who knows?
No. Okay, any other obscure questions?
Yeah.
Can the same user can log in at the same time from the environment system?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's standard FTP capability, I think. Yeah.
Do you know if it does byte range?
Does for which? For what purpose?
For resuming download or multi-threaded downloads?
I don't know off the top of my head. I don't think so. I haven't seen that anywhere if it says it has or not. I don't know. Any other questions? All right, thanks.